man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain, but if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. The Gospel of the Lord.
Good evening. My name is Anne Watt, and I'm coming to you from Newfoundland, which is Canada's easternmost province and newest province. Before 1949, we were a country, and a pretty Irish country. About half of us have Irish origins, but we were there before 1815. So it's kind of like long-lost second cousins, maybe. So it's really nice to be with you. Ordinarily, what I do is I work as the director of adult faith formation for the Archdiocese of St. John's, and I do some work in the Archbishop's office. So I also work with Redemptorists in North America, mostly around youth ministry and training adults for formation for ministry, but a few other little things too with Redemptorists. And I've been able to go to some pretty interesting places, but it was quite an honor to be asked to come to Dundalk. I've never even been to a novena, not to say spoken at one. So this is quite a gift. Thank you for this. Have you ever met a saint? Some people are nodding, most people are saying no. I have. I think we all probably have. But I'm going to tell you about one. My friend's father, his name was Kevin. When I was a young woman, I really didn't have a very good self-image. I certainly never thought I was very smart. I had no idea what I was going to do with my life, and I didn't have any good role models for the variety of things that would be open to me. I never thought about going to university because nobody I knew had ever gone to university before. And one night, while all of the kids were playing spotlight in the street, do you play spotlight here? It's like hide and seek in the dark with a flashlight. So safe. While we were doing this, he called me aside and said, have you ever thought about being a teacher? And I said, no, Mr. Tracy, I haven't thought about that. And he said, you know, you probably should. I think you'd make a good teacher, and I think that you'd do well at university. And what those few words did was opened up a whole set of possibilities that I didn't know before. And so eventually I did become a teacher. And almost every time I'm in front of a group, I give thanks to God for him. He always comes back to mind. So if you know somebody who's planted seeds of goodness and love, of possibility, of hope in your life, then you've probably met a saint. Most of those saints are in our families. The rest of the world will never know about Kevin Tracy. But I know, and because I do, a lot of other people have benefited by me encouraging them. I was able to do, or have been able to do for a lot of people, what he did for me. Now, have you ever met a saint? Yeah, sure you have. And tonight, we celebrate one of those big S saints that the church names as saints. Somebody whose goodness and example, their virtue, what the things they've been able to do were so extraordinary that the whole church calls them to mind. Saint Jared is one of the capital S saints. He doesn't just belong to your family or my family or our friends. He belongs to the whole church. So capital S saints are a bit like this. Do you ever plant a plant in a pot? And so as it grows, first you don't see the growth, but eventually you see a little shoot kind of popping out above the ground, and so you can watch it take on leaves and buds. That's what Jared's life was like. When he was on earth, he was like this shoot. What happens after saints die is one of the reasons we recognize in the saints. Their life begins to flower. And those flowers spread seeds throughout the world and across history. Saints, the big capital S saints that the church recognizes as such, actually have an effect on so many of us and spreads throughout history. We are able to do some of the things we can because we live with the example and the goodness of these saints. So, let's have a look at Jared Magella. Why do we recognize him as a saint? Why is it that we are here tonight celebrating someone who died over 250 years ago? Why is it about this man? The seeds that he spread in his life give us hints to why we're here tonight. Jared was a Redemptorist brother. You and I are not Redemptorist brothers. But as a brother, he was brother to so many, especially to his Redemptorist brothers, those in his family, but he was also brother to the poor. Everybody who met him came away enriched, enlivened. They were changed by him. His love for people, especially the poor, made him brother to all. How do we take that and translate it into our lives? You and I are called to be brothers and sisters to all of those around us, especially those in most need. If there's someone who's hurting, we are brother or sister, and we're called to do what we can to make things better. Sometimes making it better is just to listen. Often Jared wasn't able to do much. Sometimes he gave food. There's lots of stories about how he used to keep some food for those who wouldn't ask, who were too proud. Sometimes he just listened. Sometimes he actually collected money to give a dowry for a girl who was too poor to have a dowry. In those days, girls needed dowries to have good marriages. So his aid was spiritual and practical. You and I give spiritual and practical help every day to the people around us. And so Jared's seeds are sown in our lives in that way. As for his profession in life, Jared was a tailor. He worked with his hands. His dad had been a tailor and taught him something about the tailoring trade. His dad died when he was 12. And so he took on, under another tailor, a life of apprenticeship and then became a tailor himself. You and I teach other people by being kind of master craftsmen or apprentices. We are apprenticed to people every day and we apprentice others. We teach by example, we teach by kindness, we teach by the way we live our lives. So like Jared being a master craftsman, you and I are master craftsmen in the Christian craft. And we also, back further, were apprenticed to master craftsmen. We're apprenticed Christians, and we learn on the way how to be Christian by watching the example of others and doing what they do. In the Redemptorist community, Jared was the doorman, the porter. His job was to welcome people who came to the door. You and I welcome people who come to our door every day. Sometimes it's a physical door, isn't it? There are people who come to our kitchen door, our back door, our front door, and they come in and they have a tale to tell us of joy, of laughter, of sorrow, of pain, of hope or hopelessness. People come into our door all the time. But all the doors that you and I sit at are not physical doors. There are doors to our hearts. When we let in people, when we let them be part of our lives, when we extend the gift of friendship to them, we are porters or doorkeepers, like St. Jared. Sometimes our doors are in our heads. You and I welcome the ideas of other people. We've been joking with the altar servers. But sometimes young people have ideas that others might find strange. Sometimes older folks have fresh ideas that we need to consider. We have hospitality that's not just physical. We've got a psychological hospitality. And so when we welcome the ideas and the insights of other folks, we're being a doorkeeper like St. Jared. Jared had one very painful experience in his life. He was the victim of a vicious gossip campaign. So bad that he was actually taken out of his Redemptorist community and punished for something somebody had said about him, a rumor that was spread. How did he deal with it? He kept silent. He refused to either pass on the rumor or make a comment on it, even to defend himself. And in his gentleness, he finally brought about the conversion of the person who actually had spread the rumor. In his patience, Jared waited out the person who had started the rumor, and he was eventually vindicated. You and I face gossip every day. It isn't always about us, but it may be about a brother or sister. And in those times, I think Jared's example of silence is the best example of all. Not to pass on even a juicy piece of gossip is probably the best antidote to that particular disease. So Jared actually spreads a lot of seeds into our lives. That's why we honor him as a saint. Of course, what he's best known and loved for is his own love and protection for the unborn and for mothers in difficult pregnancies and deliveries. How did that happen? How did a Redemptorist brother become the patron of mothers? The story is told that one day, as he was leaving a house, he dropped his handkerchief. And a young girl ran after him, probably about your size, ran after him and gave him back his handkerchief. And he said, "Hold on to it. Someday you might have need of it." Long after Jared was dead, that girl was in a really difficult delivery. It looked as if neither she nor the child would survive. But she thought of the handkerchief. Somebody ran and got it. She put it on her belly. And the baby and the mother were spared. Both lived. So from that, Jared's intercession for those in difficult pregnancies, those who seek to become pregnant, to be parents, those who seek to adopt, those who seek to bring life into their families, call him their patron. What's that got to do with you and me? We're not going to be patrons of pregnant women. But you and I are patrons of bringing life into the world. Our actions and our words can bring life or bring death to others. And we choose life every day. Every time we choose to encourage rather than discourage, to build up rather than tear down. Every time we speak words of peace instead of words of hatred, we are seeds of gibbered. It doesn't have to be babies. Life has all kinds of ways of being born into the world. Every time we build up life, we echo Jared Magella. And so tonight, we sit here to celebrate a saint. Sometimes we think of saints as being hundreds of years old or thousands of years old, and we wonder why we call on them. I hope that tonight you realize that we can see ourselves as seeds of charity cast out into the world. It's really God's mercy, God's love, God's hospitality, and God's openness. Jared is an echo of that, and you and I are echoes too. Something like seeds cast out on the wind, echoing God's mercy when we go forth from this place and making our world a better place. What we do, there's an old song that we used to sing when I was first a teacher. It's by Joan Wise, and I want to sing it to you to end tonight, if you don't mind, so that you can put up with the croaking. Take all the lost home, remember their names all. Their journey is yours, friend. Their faces are gray till you call. Walk close by the children and learn their refrains. And leave your umbrellas while you learn to walk in the rain.
Together we're going to pray on page 6, the Novena Prayer.
Almighty God, from his boyhood years, you blessed Saint Jerome with generosity of soul and led him to do your will in heroic ways. By your grace, he lived his brief life in intense love for you and for those in need. Hear his prayers now for us and for all souls in trouble. Saint Jerome, friend of sinners, friend of the poor, friend of mothers and children, it is our joy and consolation to come to your Novena to remember the goodness of your life, your burning sense of God, your tender love for our Lord and his Mother Mary, your kindness and care for everyone in need. Pray for us now in our time of need. Pray for us in our sickness. Pray for us in our confusion and despair. Pray for us in our struggle with life and its mysteries. Remember especially those who long for children and mothers about to give birth. Remember those who have wandered from the practice of the faith and need the grace of reconciliation. Remember all of us who are sinners in our particular needs.
Blessing of the city. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Lord, hear my prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, be merciful to those you love who are sick and in distress. Ease their bodily suffering, refresh their souls, so that they may grow strong in themselves and come to a new sense of well-being through Christ our Lord. May our Lord Jesus Christ lay his hands upon you. May his love and peace fill your heart and soul. May his healing power flow into every corner of your being, to make you well in yourself and strong, to ease your aches and pains, to give you peace of mind and courage of heart, and patience in your trials. May he go before you to lead you, be behind you to guard you, and be always at your side to support you. And may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and keep you safe from harm.